You were young and your heart was an open book. You used to say, live and let live.
You know you did.
But if this ever-changing world in which we live in makes you give in and cry, say, live and let die.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my review of the second James Bond novel, Live and Let Die, written by Ian Fleming. Naturally, the first 14 books were, of course, written by Ian Fleming. The first 12 novels and the first 9 short stories were 14, but 5 of them haven't been released. Well, 2 of them have been as part of the Anthony Horowitz novels. They've been incorporated into those stories, but they haven't had the original short stories as they were released yet, nor the other 3. But anyway, never mind. So, how does Live and Let Die hold up? Well, this one is actually kind of a, I would say, mixed bag, but it's more good than bad. But the thing is, there's it fluctuates between some little bit of a slow, dull moving bit, and then it gets into a bit more interesting, exciting, not necessarily action-packed, but there's definitely more exciting stuff places. It kind of just, it goes from slow moving, some exposition, some information stuff, etc., going along, getting to the next bit, and then, oh my god, stuff's getting interesting. There's some really good stuff here. And then there's just slow, a little bit interesting, but mostly just going along the moves, and then things get a bit more interesting, and then repeat every now and again. It goes up and down between slow moving and more exciting stuff. Like I said, it's not hugely action-packed stuff. There's some good action in there and some good some great stuff, but on the whole, it's kind of a mixed bag between slow-moving and exciting and interesting stuff. Not to say that the slow stuff is not interesting, although sometimes there can be some dull moments, but for the most part, it's a good go-through. I think when it comes to writing a Bond novel, I think it's better to do the easier, slower stuff to start with and then get more exciting as we go along, but with this book, it kind of fluctuates. So, the plot of Live and Let Die, the book, sees these gold coins from Spanish and Portuguese and French ships and the odd British ship stolen by pirate and British hero Bloody Morgan are turning up in America, coming from Jamaica, and are turning up in America and being used for gold smuggling. And it's being handled by a network of black people headed by Mr. Big, a big-time New York gangster who seemingly had training from Russians when he was over helping fight in the war. He may have had some Smersh training. So he may, in fact, be a Smersh agent, or at least have some affiliation with Smersh. And after the events of Casino Royale, James Bond is more than willing to take on a Smersh agent and defeat Smersh following the events of the end of that novel. So He's sent out to America. Sorry for the noise outside, the windows are open. He soon teams up with Felix Leiter and they investigate Mr. Big together. I really love the Bond-Felix dynamic in this novel. It's just, they're like best friends who have known each other for years rather than just for a few months after the events of Casino Royale in the summer of, well, supposedly 1951, summer of 1951 or 52. And now this is early 52, 53. But yeah, when it's supposedly set, not when the novel came out. It came out in 54. But, well, it's paperback in 2012, the original in 54. But my point is, despite only knowing each other for a few months, they seem to be getting along like they've known each other for years. Like how Bond and Mathis did. But actually, even more buddy than that. And I just love the Bond and Leiter interactions in this novel, Felix Leiter. He's so good. I loved him in Casino Royale, but he's such amazing in Live and Let Die. He's so great. And they just hang out together really nicely. And he gets a little bit into the action earlier on as well, with the first time they meet Mr. Big and Leiter's dragged off to go somewhere else whilst Bond meets Mr. Big himself. But Leiter is able to get himself to have a little adventure of his own back down there. And even might have made a friend with one of the Negro criminal guys. As for Bond, he just kills a couple of people trying to escape. makes sense. But yeah, they get along really well together, and it's great to have interactions between each other at points throughout the novel. I'll talk a little bit more about this later on, because I'm going to talk specifically about a bit around chapter 14, 15 time. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a bit. But first, our villain, Mr. Big, a big black gangster from New York, well, maybe from the Caribbean, but heading up in New York, who has ties to Smersh. He's a pretty interesting villain. In this novel, compared to the film, it's just one guy. It's not Dr. Kananga disguising himself as a gangster called Mr. Big. It's a guy just called Mr. Big. There's actually a reason stated earlier on in the book that gives him the name Mr. Big as a nickname. He, however, does sometimes is perceived by his gang as being a form of a Baron Samedi, a voodoo priest, in the film, Baron Samedi was one of Dr. Kananga's henchmen. Mr. Big himself is perceived to be Baron Samedi, as I've just mentioned. So, Mr. Big obviously doesn't want Bond interfering with his plans and tries in a couple of ways to try and get rid of him at some points. But other times he's just trying to make sure he doesn't interfere. We also get introduced to Solitaire, who is the only white person in this organisation. Probably because Mr. Big just fancied her, basically. He took her in as someone who read predicts the truth. Somehow she's able to tell if people are telling the truth, maybe even predict the future sometimes. And she does not want to be there, basically. A bit like in the film version, except there isn't much card play in this version. The film one has a lot more card play. And the fact that she's able to tell whether someone's telling the truth or lying, and being able to predict the future, somehow comes from a gift that she loses once she has sex with someone for the first time. In other words, losing her virginity. Not sure how that works. Then again, it's a kind of questionable how she's able to predict the future and tell the truth in this version as well. But yeah, Solitaire. Once again, Ian Fleming can't really write female characters particularly well. They're mostly just, well, this Solitaire, especially in this novel, is a prize for Bond to win. She is basically the prize at the end. She's the damsel in distress, probably the most iconic damsel in distress Bond girl in both the books and the films, to be honest. She's basically there just to be a damsel in distress. At least in the film, she actually does a few other things, like helping Bond escape and having a moment or two with Kananga after losing her virginity to Bond, and she fails to tell the truth and Kananga gets pissed off. At least we get a couple more moments with her in the film where we get to see more of a character. But like Vesper in Casino Royale, Solitaire's just there, basically. She's there for Bond to win at the end. She goes with him around chapter 9, chapter 10, 11-ish. She does go with Bond for a bit, and they do hang out with each other for a bit, but there's not really much of a character there, not really. She's all right as a person, but a nice girl. And to be honest, any straight or bisexual man would not say no to her as a prize. So, no offence. But as a character, she's not that great or interesting. She's just there for a female presence. And basically to be first the damsel in distress and second the prize at the end. And yeah, so yeah, she might even be a step down from Vesper, because at least Vesper had some sort of a personality towards the end of the novel. At least we got to know a bit more about her in the final chapter. At least when she started to have a bit of a mental breakdown, it was a change in personality. Solitaire's just bland. Basically, she's just bland, and she's just there, and she's just the typical, oh, I love you, James, Mr. Bond, and basically falling all over him and everything. Not really doing much else. That seems to be an issue with Fleming Bond girls. They're not that interesting, most of them. So Solitaire, a bit of a disappointment. At least in the film, she got a bit more personality. She got a bit more to do. So yeah, that's a shame. Anyway. So now we come to around the middle of the book. Solitaire has been captured after going with Bond. She's escaped Mr. Big and joined Bond on his travels, but then she gets kidnapped when they're down in St. Petersburg. Florida, not Russia. Yeah, I know, it's a bit strange, but you know, there are plenty of cities and towns in the world that share lots of names. There's quite a few Alexandras, the most notable's in Egypt. But yeah, so they go down to St. Petersburg, Florida, USA, and it's in some sort of, it's when Bond and Felix are out that Solitaire gets kidnapped, and we don't really see her again until towards the end of the book. Meanwhile, Liza then goes out one night to investigate this, well, they've gone to have a look at this worm and mackerel plant, I think, like fish bait and stuff, place. They had a look earlier, and that's when Solitaire was kidnapped, and now Felix has gone to have a look down there because they believe that's the headquarters of one of Mr. Big's henchmen, the robber. However, when investigating, Felix accidentally falls down a trap hole and into a bit of a into a shark tank, where he gets his arm and leg bitten off or mauled by a shark, maybe also a bit of the face as well. The robber says that it was his own fault he tripped, and the guys had to get him out quickly. Woe Bond suspects that it may have, the robber or the henchman may have loosened the bolt deliberately, so then Felix would walk over that bit, and then they'd have a little bit of a laugh before putting him out. That does seem plausible, because they then write the jokey note. He disagreed with something that ate him. P.S. We have plenty more jokes where this came from. And then Bond sets out to find out, go into the worm and bait warehouse and investigate. And he finds out that Mr. Big is smuggling the gold coins through the bottom of the fish tanks of poisonous and deadly fish. And he has an encounter with the robber where he is told everything. And then he makes sure the robber meets the same fate Felix did, except on a much nastier level, by being eaten by a shark. And then Bond sets off to Jamaica to meet up with Commander Strangways and Quarrel, a local fisherman helping Strangways. And they, well, Bond and Quarrel do some training to get ready for Bond being able to walk underneath water, walk on a coral bed to get under Shark Bay to get to the cave, having to avoid barracuda and sharks on the way. However, a battle with an octopus gets Bond spotted, and he eventually escapes, but is wounded by a barracuda passing by, and is then captured by Mr. Big and his gang. And then he and Solitaire get tied up together and thrown on the back of the boat when morning comes, so that sharks and barracuda would then be able to eat them after they get their bodies scraped against the coral. However, Bond has placed a mine on the bottom of the ship, meaning that it will blow up with Mr. Big and everybody else on board, and all the gold coins, which it does after a bit of a delay, but eventually the ship blows up, and whilst there are survivors, they swiftly get eaten by barracuda and sharks, including Mr. Big himself, which gets a kind of gruesome end when a shark eats him in pieces. And eventually Bond and Solitaire are rescued by Quarrel, and they get a fortnight in sleep whilst being looked after by Strangways and Quarrel. And Felix, of course, is going to make it. We got word of that a few chapters before the end. So, Live and Let Die. As you can tell, it's a little bit all over the place in terms of some slower stuff early on, especially in the earliest chapters. But you get some really good, interesting stuff. I really enjoy Bond's interactions with Felix in the first half of the novel. It's just really engaging. I think the New York stuff is probably the weakest, although this is the most faithful stuff translated to the film. And then once we get to St. Petersburg, Florida, we've got some interesting stuff here with Solitaire's kidnapping and Felix falling into the shark tank and Bond's investigation of the worm and bait factory. And film viewers may recognise some of these sequences from being in the 1989 Bond film License to Kill. And that's because the 73 Live and Let Die film was a very different film to the book. It was a bit different. They kept quite some of the earlier stuff, like Bond meeting Mr. Big, although slightly handled differently. Teehee, who's one of the henchmen earlier on but dies, is a prominent henchman in the film and even comes back at the end for one last go at Bond. It's also worth noting that in the book, Teehee does bend Bond's little finger back, which in the film we see he's about to cut it off at one point. We also have the Whisper, who is a character in the film, but again, he's a bit more prominent, although he doesn't really get an awful lot to do in that film, to be honest. He's the switchboard operator in this book, where he's like the go-between between the two people, like from Mr. Big to his people out on the streets. He doesn't get an awful lot to do. I think he's slightly more prominent in the film, but I don't, again, he doesn't get an awful lot to do apart from killing Bond's cabbie in that, and also being his waiter at the hotel, I think. Summary Hotel. But yeah, Whisper's not a very prominent character in either version, to be honest. But anyway, moving on to the Jamaican stuff, this could be similar to the stuff on Saint Marie, but there isn't. It's very different. I do enjoy the Bond-Strangway's quarrel relationship, and we're going to see a bit more of the Bond-quarrel relationship, at least, when we get to Dr. No, as film viewers will be aware of. And eventually we get to the end, we get to a climax with Mr. Big. It is a bit different to the film. The film does incorporate Bond and Solitaire being tied to a metal thing and being lowered into a shark tank, basically, to be eaten, or at least they try to. Anyway, here, instead, they tie Bond up, tie Bond and Solitaire together, and they tow them from the back of a boat. Again, film viewers will recognise this from being in For Your Eyes Only, 1981's For Your Eyes Only, which they incorporated this portion of the story into that book. And even one or two lines from this book get altered and used in that film. So it's pretty cool that what wasn't used in the Live and Let Die film did get used in later films. The back of the boat, pool telling of Bond and his leading lady of the book and film were used in For Your Eyes Only. And the whole stuff at the Macron Worm factory and with Felix Leiter getting his part of him bitten off by a shark, and the note being left back at the hut appears in License to Kill. So that's pretty neat. As for this book itself, I enjoyed the plot when it was moving. There were some good elements in the slower bits, but ultimately it does meander. There's a lot of filler, there's a lot of waiting, but when it's focused on telling the story, it goes for it. I enjoy Bond a little bit more in this book than I did in Casino Royale. He's a bit more of a better character. He's a bit nicer. And I enjoy the characters for the most part. Like I said, I think Solitaire's a bit of a bland character, but she's still nice. And Mr. Big's a pretty great villain. I love Felix. And I enjoyed Strangways and Quarrel in this book as well. I think they're going to be... Well, Quarrel, at least. Strangways is going to die at the start of Doctor No. The film viewers will know this. But... yeah, I think Bond and Quarrel are going to have a good relationship in Doctor No. And I look forward to that, as well as future meetings with Felix Leiter, as there will be more meetings with Felix Leiter, again, as the film viewers will know. But yeah, characters are fine and it's pretty enjoyable. Like Casino Royale, this book starts off with a little bit when Bond arrives in America before jumping back to 2 weeks where he gets his mission from M, and then he arrives in America and we carry on the story as we were. So it's not a very linear story to begin with, but then it gets a bit more linear as we go along. Sadly, like Casino Royale, this is a novel of the time, and it is slightly derogative of black people and Negroes. On the more positive side, they are mainly referred to as Negroes, but the other N-word does get used very rarely, but does appear at least once or twice. And also, some of the coral towards the end is sometimes referred to as N-word head. I'm not quite sure if it's supposed to be a word for some coral or sandy reef or anything in the reef, but yeah, it does make a notable appearance. Chapter 5 is literally called N-word Heaven. Ouch. That's going to be awkward when people are reading out on the audiobooks. Anyway, product of the time, racism, and maybe some mild sexism as well, out of the way. Live and Let Die is still a really good book. There are a few issues, like it is a bit slow in the pacing in some places, and it meanders, and there's some filler, and Solitaire is not a particularly amazing character. She's nice, but she's not particularly amazing. But besides all that, Live and Let Die is still a pretty good book, and in places, an enjoyable read. And yeah, I think it's a good Bond adventure. Not perfect, but still a good Bond adventure. It's still easing ourselves into the formula of Bond, but I think this one kicks off a bit more of the formula than Casino Royale. Although I think the next novel would definitely start up the formula a little bit more. And then by Diamonds Are Forever from Rush for Love, we've got the formula of the Bond books that would be incorporated into the films and would be therefore recognisable to book readers and film audiences. So on the whole, I'm going to give Live and Let Die a 8 out of 10.
What does it matter to you when you got a job to do? You gotta do it well. You got to give the other fella hell.
I think it's weaker than Casino Royale because at least Casino Royale stayed focused, even when it meandered and had some filler stuff. It was at least relevant to the character. Well, you do get some of this in here as well. But it still kept the story moving before we got to the main stuff, and then afterwards as well with some character stuff. It was also not a very long novel. It was about 229 pages total, so it wasn't very long. But this one, there's a bit more plot, but there's also a bit more meandering and slower stuff. And the total pages for this publication, at least, is 307. So it's a bigger story, and there's more stuff going on. But that also means there's a little bit more slower stuff as well, and a bit more meandering in places. So that's why I think Casino Royale is slightly better, because it at least gets to the point quicker. Whilst Live and Let Die meanders now and again, and like I said, sometimes it's slow moving, maybe some interesting stuff, some relevant stuff as well, but ultimately it's still just taking its time. And then we get the faster paced stuff, we got some more interesting stuff, like meeting Mr. Big, Felix being bitten by a shark, and the climax. Some really great stuff, and a nice, soft, calm ending at the very end. But I think maybe it could have been structured a little bit more better. It's no wonder that the film went a bit of a different route. It tried to do some things a little bit differently, but on the whole I think the book still works really well. It's also nice that Ian Fleming got to write about Jamaica for a bit, where he went on his holidays and where he wrote these novels, although he does go to Jamaica quite a lot in the novels. But for the first time, it's really neat, and it gets a bit more utilised when we get to Dr. No. So that was Live and Let Die, pretty great book. And before we wrap up, I just want to quickly say which of the two versions I prefer, whether I prefer the book or whether I prefer the film. I forgot to do this for Casino Royale. For Casino Royale, I prefer the book to the 1954 and the 1967 films, 54 TV pro version, which I gave a 4 out of 10, and the 67 one I gave a 5 out of 10, because it was still enjoyable. It was a mess, but it was an enjoyable mess. You could still have fun with it. The book I gave a 9, but the 2006 film I gave a 10 out of 10, so I preferred the film from Eon, the Eon 2006 Daniel Craig film, over the novel, but I prefer the novel over the other two versions that came to screen. As for Live and Let Die, again, the film gets a 10 out of 10, whilst this is only an 8. So once again, the film is better than the novel in my personal opinion. I just prefer, or at least I prefer it anyway. However, this isn't always going to case, as the next novel will prove, that I will prefer some of the novels over some of the films. And the next one is going to be the prime example, as next time James Bond stays home. When I say stays home, he stays in the UK, doesn't stay in his flat for the whole adventure, but he stays in the UK for the third James Bond novel, Moonraker, which we'll be looking at next time. And this is so not like the film. It's fucking better. So thank you for watching my review of Live and Let Die, the book. Next time, my review of Moonraker, the book. Goodbye. Don't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel.